All right. Good to see everybody here this evening, and what a beautiful day, wasn't it? My, oh, my, oh, my. I get used to that. And good to see you in church tonight. Take a songbook. Let's start by singing together. Springs of Living Water, 327 in your book, 327. Let's all stand together to sing. Everybody standing, Brother Bob will lead us.
I thirsted in the barren land of sin and shame, and nothing satisfying there I found. But to the blessed cross of Christ one day I came, where springs of living water did abound. Drinking at the springs of living water, happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water, oh, wonderful and bountiful supply. How sweet the living water from the hills of God. It makes me glad and happy all the way. Now glory, grace, and blessing mark the path I've trod. I'm shouting hallelujah every day. I'm drinking at the springs of living water. Happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water. Oh, wonderful and bountiful supply. Oh, sinner, won't you come today to Calvary? Deep and wide, the Savior now invites you to the water free, where thirsty spirits can be satisfied. I'm drinking at the springs of living water. Happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water. Oh, wonderful and bountiful supply.
All right, good to see you here this evening. And we're going to hear from our Pats Clubs tonight, and as well as observe the Lord's table. And it's going to be a great service together this evening, our Good Wednesday service. And we'll say more about that in just a little bit. But I'm glad you're here. Let's pray together, and then we'll hear from the children. All right. Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for another opportunity for us to gather together here in the house of God. Thank you for each one that's made their way here tonight. And Father, we do bow before you here at the beginning of the service. And we do ask in a special way that we'll sense your presence here tonight. We sure do need you, Lord. And I pray you give us what we need here in the middle of the week. Thank you for so loving us that you would give your only begotten Son to die on the cross for our sins. Thank you for so great salvation that you provided for us. Now, Father, bless the children as they sing. Lord, I pray that you'll help each one of them to do their very best and to remember what they have practiced and to sing heartily as unto the Lord. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated. Hold on. Are you just going to stand in the aisleway? Are you going to come up and sit down? You're just going to stand. Okay, go ahead.
Sharing.
right, good job. And it's Tanya Reed's birthday today as well. So happy birthday to Tanya. And bye-bye. Let them go to their class. Good job. Let's sing a song, Bob. All right. Let's do the solid rock. Let's sing 477, all right? 477, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less, on Christ the Solid Rock. Just do the first and last stanzas, all right? 477.
On that first together. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, called to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. Amen.
Tonight's letters from the Zwingles, missionaries to Russia. Greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ for what he is doing in St. Petersburg, Russia. Dear saints in Christ, we thank you for your kind love, prayers, and support. A tremendous blessing to us, and we thank the good Lord for you all. The last few months have been eventful in both stress and joys. As our daughter Christina has celebrated her sixth birthday in February, and during this time we have been hit with a few more diagnostics about her from some doctors. Some of you may know that our daughter is officially handicapped and is progressing at a slower rate than normal children her age, both physically and mentally. The latest we have recently been told is that she is suffering from a serious case of flat foot valgus. And then in parentheses, he puts Google it. It is more severe in her left foot than the other, and we have no doubt she will need to have surgery on at least one. On another note, we have been told that she may have a minor case of hip dysplasia and needs to be observed. This is just a number of problems she has, and we ask that you pray for her and for us. We need wisdom on how to approach these cases with her, along with the others she already has. Pray for Christina's salvation, mental and physical health state. Thank you. Russia Easter is soon upon us, and we as a church have been planning out our outreach to the lost. I will say that I am very happy to see the church body stepping up and doing this themselves without relying on their pastor to do all the work. A real blessing to see them want to serve the Lord. There is a new family that has been visiting our church for the last month. They have moved to St. Petersburg and have been very faithful, even to Bible studies. We're not sure if they will join or even stay in the city, but we are thankful for them. Two of our ladies have just returned from another missions trip to India and reported back to us their new ministry to help orphan children out. I cannot imagine knowing how the Lord builds up his people to live for him. What a blessing to see this young Russian church that is only 7 years old participate in the world missions work. Yes, we have some trials, but all is well when you are faithful to Scripture and letting the Holy Spirit do as he desires. Spring is now here, and we will be handing out gospel tracts again soon. I have made up some brand new tracts and would like to get them printed. I think they should go over well. We have been serving soup in a homeless shelter every other Sunday after church and are thankful for the opportunity to speak with these people about Jesus Christ. Very difficult lives they have for sure. I would like to remind you to please continue to pray for two men. Both of them have come to this shelter and are now coming to our church. They both have heard the gospel, but neither have repented. Pray for Mikhail and Boris. Also, I had mentioned in our last letter to pray for two college girls named Olga and Kira. They have still been coming to our home to study the Bible and ask questions. Kier was asking about fasting and the Passover, so we were able to show her the gospel by studying the Passover. Olga has been coming to church, and now Kira has begun to come as well. Please remember them in your prayers to be saved. Remember to pray for a Georgian woman who is the wife of one of our church members. Her name is Pickley, and she is without Christ. With the Russia economy suffering, we are seeing an increased strength in the dollar. We need funds to buy an apartment for the church. Please pray for funds to come in and to help us. Thank you for your support. The Zwingles.
Good report from them, serving in a difficult place, and not only, you know, the being on a foreign field and working with people in another nation, but dealing with a daughter that has some physical challenges as well. And so you just lift them up in prayer, and I hope you do that for our missionaries on a regular basis and go through them and lift them up. Yeah, you just never know what all they're facing while they're on the mission field. And so those prayers make a difference. They really do. All right. We're going to have opportunity to observe the Lord's table this evening. This is what I believe is Good Wednesday. I believe that's the day Christ died. I don't, if Jesus said there's no sign be given a generation but the sign of the prophet Jonas. As Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And if you try to get 3 day time periods, which is 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., and 3 night time periods, which is 6 p.m. to 6 a.m., then you can never get that from Friday to Sunday. It's an impossibility. But you can get that. And by the way, where people get confused sometimes is they say the Sabbath was the next day. But when you read John 19, you find out in parentheses the Lord tells us something there, that it was a high Sabbath. That would have been on a Thursday. The high Sabbath would have been. And that's just a yearly Sabbath that was observed. And that was observed during that time. And so they had to get the bodies down from the cross before 6 p.m. on Wednesday night, because like right now, if we were on Jewish time, it would already be Thursday morning, because at 6:01, 6 o'clock starts the new day, like our midnight starts the new day. So that's how that works. So I believe Wednesday is the day that Christ died, and we get to observe the Lord's table tonight. Again, there's no saving power in the elements of the table here this evening. Jesus simply said, as oft as you do it in remembrance of me. It's our way of remembering and focusing on the death and the suffering of Jesus, the shedding of his blood, the giving of his body on the cross as a sacrifice for our sin. If we don't take time to remember, we surely will forget. And we will not appreciate what the Lord has done for us. And so the Lord gave us this. The juice, of course, is unleavened. It's just juice. It's not wine. And the bread is unleavened, because leaven in the Bible was always a symbol of sin. And there was no sin in the body of Christ. He became sin for us when he had no sin, that we might have the righteousness of God in him. And the requirements for the Lord's table, of course, is that you know the Lord is your Savior. It is a table of fellowship with the Lord, that you have put your faith and trust in him, and you know you're saved and you belong to him. And the other requirement is that, as far as you know, you're living in obedience to him. There's no known sin in your life. And in other words, there's no known area where you know that God says one thing and you're fighting him on that. You're holding off on that. As far as you know, you yield him. None of us are without sin, obviously, but we can be without any known rebellion against God. And what we do is we always have a time of examination before we come to the table. That's not for you to examine anybody else, but for you to examine your own heart and for you to ask God to examine your heart. And if there's anything between you and the Savior, you would want to take care of that. And you would want to confess that and forsake it so you can come to the table. If you're not a Christian here this evening, then you would not partake of the table. And if you would choose not to get right with God, if you have something in your life that's against him and you say, I'm just not willing to make that right, then you're better off not to take the table. The people in Corinth had some that took the table unworthily and in an abusive way, not examining their own heart. And God said, for this cause, many among you are sick, and some of you even sleep. Some of you even died prematurely because they took of the table unworthily. And so it's a very serious time. It's a very solemn time. Time of reflection, and what we like to do is, as we prepare to serve you the Lord's table, I'd like for you to just bow your head at your seat there, if you would, and use it as a time of reflection and a time for asking God to search your heart. And if everything's clear between you and the Savior, then this is the time you think about your salvation and when He saved you, and think about His suffering on the cross, and just spend some time thanking the Savior and loving the Savior for so loving you to die on the cross for your sins. And we'll prepare to serve you the Lord's table. Our Heavenly Father, as we bow before you in prayer this evening, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that's ours to come to the table tonight. And we want to thank you, Jesus, for being willing to come and lay down your life, that no man took it, but you laid it down. And you laid it down, and we know that 3 days later you raised it up again. Father, we're so grateful and that you gave your Son to die on the cross for our sins. Thank you, Jesus, for being willing to be mocked and beaten and scourged and nailed to a cross, to suffer, to bleed, to die for us. Thank you for giving your body. Thank you for being the Lamb of God that'll take away the sin of the world. Thank you for shedding your blood, for it's the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, that cleanses us from all sin. We just want to say we love you this evening. And I pray, Lord, that as a result of our time together tonight and our remembering afresh and anew your sacrifice for us, that our dedication and our consecration to Thee would be renewed and refreshed as well. Meet with us and draw nigh to us during these next few minutes as we seek to draw nigh to you. And we ask it in our Savior's name. Amen. Thank you. Again, we mentioned earlier the bread is unleavened bread because leaven was a symbol of sin, and Christ had to be sinless. That's why he was born of a virgin. He was born sinless. He lived a sinless life, tempted in all points, like as we are, the scripture says, yet without sin. And that's important, so then he could go and be the sacrifice for sin, and he could take our sin on himself. I cannot die for your sins because I got my own to pay for. You couldn't die for anybody else's because you have your own to pay for. Only an innocent substitute, a lamb without spot, without blemish. And that was the Lord Jesus. Brother Bob Wallace, lead us in prayer this evening, thanking Jesus for giving his body on the cross. Again, the grape juice would represent the blood of Jesus Christ all the way back to the very first sin in the Garden of Eden when God took two animals and shed their blood and took their skins and clothed Adam and Eve. It's always been a blood sacrifice that God required as a covering for sin. When Cain and Abel brought their offering, Abel's was accepted because he brought a lamb. He brought a blood offering. Cain brought of the fruit of his own hands. And thus began the battle that still goes on today. How do we approach God? Is it by our works? Is it by the fruit of our hands? Or is it by the sacrifice of an innocent substitute? And we believe the Bible teaches it's by the sacrifice of an innocent substitute. And that was the Lamb of God that took away the sin of the world, Jesus Christ. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission for sin. So the blood had to be shed. and Jesus willingly shed his blood on the cross so we could have forgiveness of sin. And I'd like Brother Taylor to stand, lead us in our prayer tonight, thanking Jesus for shedding his blood on the cross. Should be a little place in the back of the seat there that you can put your cup in. We'll collect those when the service is over this evening. We're going to sing a song together. Number 151, Hallelujah, What a Savior. We do have a visitor with us, I think, this evening. This young gentleman right here. Tell us who you are and where you're from.
My name is Joseph Sedby. I'm from near Richmond, Virginia. I'm here for work.
So. Okay. Praise the Lord. Thanks for stopping in and being in church tonight. Wonderful. Great to have you tonight. Thank you. And of course, it's good to see Jack Sherry Jarvis in town. And glad they're with us tonight as well. Good to see you folks. They forced themselves to leave Florida and come up to Ohio. And good to see them here. Amen. All right. Good to have Jeanette home. And who was with you now? Nathaniel?
Yes.
And out in California. And I was telling her I appreciate her bringing the warm weather back with her. And that was nice, and enjoyed it. That's good. All right, 151, Hallelujah, What a Savior. Let's stand together to sing it. All right, all of us standing, Brother Bob will lead us.
On that first together, Man of Sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Let's take a couple of stanzas, greet one another, make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing those last stanzas together. Thank you. Let's sing that third together. Guilty, vile, and helpless, we, spotless Lamb of God, was he. Guilty, vile, and helpless, we, spotless Lamb of God, was he. Full atonement, can it be? Hallelujah! What a Savior! Lifted up, was he to die? Lifted up to die. It is finished, was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high. Hallelujah! What a Savior! Then on that last, when he comes, our glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring on that last. When he comes, our glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring, then anew this song we'll sing, Hallelujah! What a Savior!
Good singing. You can be seated. Ushers will come and they'll get our offering now tonight. Give us the Lord as blessed and prospered you. We will, this will go towards our country fair again. We've got the things ordered and that we're going to be using that day. And I hope you'll give towards that day and be praying about what you're doing Sunday. Hope you're prepared for that offering come the Lord's day and what the Lord has laid on your heart to do that you'll do. And we'll trust God to take care of those needs on that day. We'll prepare best we can. May 16th will be here before we know it. And it's moving right along. And we're excited about what God's going to do. Well, we do have some flyers downstairs on the table for the Down East Boys concert, which will be the 18th of April. They're half sheets. Now, we only have, how many? I think 300 or so. So don't take, you know, these aren't necessarily to go out and go door to door with, but they are to use to invite people to come. And then we do have some 11 by 17 sheets that we'll put down there. That's where I want you to make sure one goes in the barbershop down here, laundromats, other churches. If you know other churches and you can go there and just say, hey, can we put this, you know, put this poster up and let folks know about this concert. It's on Saturday evening. It won't conflict with the church services and places like that. And they're real nice posters. Bring those in so we can show them, Bob, at the end, all right? We'll have him get those so you can see them. And we'll have those ready for you, all right? All right, let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for the privilege. It's ours to give. And thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. Father, you're far better than what any of us deserve. And thank you for meeting our needs, and we trust you'll meet the needs for this big day in May. Lord, we know you always have, and you always come through, and Lord, we trust you to do so again this year. So bless the giving tonight of your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Sally. Right. Take your Bible this evening. Go to Luke 23. Would you please? Luke chapter 23. Luke 23, I'd like us to, if you look with me at verse number 32, where the Bible says, there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. And the people stood beholding. And the rulers also with them derided him, saying, He saved others, let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen of God. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew. This is the King of the Jews. And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, If thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture here this evening. And Lord, as we turn our attention to the cross, and particularly, Lord, this event on the cross, as Christ is dying for our sins, and yet in his dying moment receives another one into his kingdom. And Father, I pray that you'd help us to glean some things from this incident on the cross that you've recorded for us in the scriptures. We would glean some truths that would help us, would encourage us, would challenge us. So Spirit of God, be our teacher. Help me as I bring the message, and help each individual as they listen tonight. Help us to be focused. Help us to concentrate. And give us ears to hear what the Spirit would say to each of us this evening. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. It's an amazing conversion. Whenever you picture the crucifixion, you know there were three crosses on that hill called Calvary. Jesus in the center cross and a criminal on either side of him. Malefactors, the Bible calls him, by the way, fulfillment of prophecy, that he would be numbered among the transgressors. And just in the crucifixion and the events surrounding the crucifixion alone, there are nearly 300 prophecies fulfilled. Amen. And initially, as you read, I think it's in the Gospel of Matthew, initially, both of these thieves mocked the Savior. They joined in with others who were ridiculing the Son of God, along with the scribes and the elders. Both of them unbelievers. And it's important to remember that, because you're going to find out that one of these thieves has a change of heart. But it was not anything he did prior to being crucified. There was nothing good in him at all. In fact, both of these men were not just common thieves. They probably, most people believe, were insurrectionists. Much as Barabbas was, who ended up getting released and Jesus taking his place. Probably had they not done that, the crucifixion probably was set for those three. But Barabbas got to be released. We don't know exactly. Maybe as he heard Jesus ask forgiveness of the mockers. That's the first thing Jesus said from the cross was, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." Maybe that began to soften his heart, or maybe that began to have him look at Jesus just a little bit different. But whatever it was, and we'll discuss some of those things, he, of his own free will, makes the decision to trust Jesus Christ as his Savior. The other thief could have done the same thing, but he didn't. Three crosses. Jesus on the middle cross. That's not just of little significance. Because Jesus Christ on the middle cross and an unbeliever on one side and a believer on the other side is indicative of what Jesus Christ does even up to today. People divide over Jesus Christ. And here is one on the left who is an unbeliever, and the one on the right that becomes a believer. And it lets us know, really, all of mankind is only ever divided, by the way, into two categories, saved and lost. Saved and lost. Well, there's all these races, and there's all these nationalities, and there's all these economic groups. No, saved and lost. Saved and lost. That's all it is. On the middle cross, the Redeemer. On one cross, a rejecter. On another cross, a receiver. One belligerent, one believing. One cursing, the other trusting. One in hell now for 2,000 years. One in heaven with Jesus for 2,000 years. Charles Spurgeon said, "The thief on the cross was Jesus' last companion on earth and his first companion in heaven." Never thought about that. Now think about the statement Jesus made in response to this man asking to be remembered. Verse 43, Jesus makes this statement, "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." Here's a man who says, "Lord, remember me," and Jesus says, "Today, you'll be with me in paradise." My friend, it's a deathbed conversion. It's the fellow who waited to the last possible moment to get saved, and he got saved. Notice what Jesus didn't say, though. He didn't say, "Whoa, just hold on there, buddy. You're not living your whole life for yourself and for sin and for wickedness and then try and get into heaven at the last minute." Jesus didn't say that. Jesus didn't say, "Sorry, you can't be baptized, so you can't be saved." Jesus didn't say, "Wait a minute, it's too late for you. You haven't made restitution for the wrongs you've done in your life." Jesus didn't look at him and say, "Well, you don't look sorry enough for your past sins." Or Jesus didn't say, "I don't see any fruit in your life. I'm not sure you're really saved." Jesus didn't say, "I'm sorry. You're not really saved unless I hear you speak in tongues." It's interesting what Jesus didn't say, as well as what he did say. But he was not too lost, and he was not too late to be saved. Hallelujah. See, the repentant one, that's what he was, he died to his sin. The one on the other side, the unrepentant one, the unbelieving one, he died in his sin. And the one in the middle was Christ, and he was dying for our sin. The thief knew Christ was innocent. It's an amazing thing. He knew that he deserved to be there. He knew that he deserved the punishment. He told the other thief, "We're getting what we really deserve. We deserve to die like this." So he understood that he deserved it, but Jesus didn't. He was the sinless Son of God. You know, the Bible says in 1 Peter 2 and verse 22 that Christ did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. That's an amazing verse. Not just that he did no sin, but it says, neither was guile found in his mouth. Guile is craftiness, it's cunningness, it's deceit. Have you discovered that probably most of our sins are done with our mouth? That tongue sure is in a slippery place. And the Bible says, in the multitude of words there wanteth not sin. And you know why that it's so amazing? You know why the tongue can get you in trouble and why your words can get you in trouble? Because your words come from your heart. And the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. That's why we have trouble with the tongue. And buddy, if Christ gets hold of your heart and you begin to let Him rule in your heart and sit on the throne of your heart, you'd be amazed how much your speech cleans up. You'd be amazed how it changes the way you talk. How could Jesus never have any guile, never have any sin, never speak in a cunning or a deceitful way? Because His heart was pure. That's why. At some point, the thief realized that Christ was innocent and he was guilty. At some point, the thief realized all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. At some point, that thief realized that he was deserving of his sin, deserving of his punishment, and Jesus was not. What made him realize that Christ really was who he said he was? I think it may have been the statement that Pilate made. In fact, it may have been the message that Pilate put at the top of the cross. What was that message? Here in Luke, he says, "This is the King of the Jews." When you put Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, all the accounts together, it says, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." And remember, they tried to get Pilate to take it off. Remember what he said? "What I've written, I've written." I know I've heard people talk about Pilate wringing his hands in hell still, you know, saying, "I want nothing to do with that just man." I still have some hope for Pilate because of what he did right there. He wouldn't back down. And he kept that sign there. You know, there's power in the name of Jesus. That's why the world hates that name. Oh, you know, you pray or you talk about God if you want, and though they're even getting to where they're a little edgy about that. But boy, you talk about Jesus and they throw their hands up and say, "Let's stop that right now." When he saw Jesus and he saw that message over the cross of Christ, he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And that's when he rebukes the other thief and says, "Dost thou not fear God? Don't you fear God?" Boy, that's a good question for today, isn't it? Don't you fear God? Let me just stick a little parenthesis in here, okay? I'm for Indiana and the other 19 states that have passed their freedom of religion law. First of all, you shouldn't even have to pass a freedom of religion law in America. It's already guaranteed by something called the First Amendment. But that's how far we've degenerated. And by the way, this is how far we've come in just 20-some years. In 1993, Congress, the United States Senate, passed this very law that Indiana just passed as a state. 1990, Bill Clinton was the president. And the Senate passed the law 97-3. Means a whole lot of liberal Democrats passed it as well. And now listen, just 22 short years later,
they're completely against it. And listen, nobody's. It's just you have a right. If my religious conviction says that I'm not going to provide flowers for your homosexual wedding or lesbian wedding, I don't have to provide flowers for your wedding. Unfortunately, there are people out there who will, but let them do it. It doesn't have to be me. And you ought to have the right to do that. Listen, don't you fear God? That's the question to ask. Why wouldn't you do something like that? Because I fear God. I want to do what's right in God's sight. That's all. We have that problem in America. Oh, God is love and God is forgiving and God is merciful. And He is. Make no mistake about that. But let's not forget that God is also just and God is also holy. And God will judge not only the world, He'll judge us. We must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Let's not forget it is still a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. We've lost that. Jesus said, Matthew 10 and verse 28, "Fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear Him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." And my friend, the only one that is able to do that is God. The thief had no self-justification. He had no excuses. He's at the end of his life. He's at the end of the road. And he knows it. He's facing eternity without God and without hope. And he knows it. But I got news for you. That's every one of us in this room. David said, "There's but a step between me and death." That's it for all of us. There's but a step between us and death. So the thief repents. He places faith in Jesus Christ. And by the way, repentance and faith are two sides of the same coin. Can't have one without the other. You ever think about that, though? I mean, here's the thing. You and I are on this side of all of it. Yes, Christ was crucified. He was beaten, scourged, bloodied, crucified, died. He was buried, but He rose again. He was alive and seen by over 500 at once, and then 40 days later, He ascended up to heaven, where now He's at the right hand of God, and He ever lives to make intercession for us. And we've read the end of the book. We just studied the book of Revelation. We know that He's coming back, and He's going to come back with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And He's going to establish His kingdom. And listen, so when we understand that about Christ and somebody says, "Man, you need to trust this Christ as your Savior and your Lord." And we say, "Absolutely, I will." But think about the thief. He's looking at a bloodied man. Isaiah tells us the visage of Christ, the appearance of Christ was so marred we couldn't tell He was a human being. No Hollywood production will ever do it justice. And he sees him nailed to the cross and gasping for air. The crown of thorns and the blood coming down him. His bones, he says, in the Old Testament, the bones are staring at him. All of his bones out of joint. He's looking at that and saying, "Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come to your kingdom." He sure didn't look like a king. They're all mocking him. He heard them mocking him. "Hey, where's his followers? They're all gone. One is there, John, and he's not saying anything." He's being absolutely quiet. Yet he places his faith in Jesus Christ. That's really incredible. It is really amazing. But he realized, I think he realized, I have no other place to go. And neither do you or I. We have no other place to go. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. He's the only Savior. And he received the promise, today you will be with me in paradise. He couldn't walk an aisle to publicly make his profession of faith. He was never baptized. He never made restitution for what he'd done. He never showed a changed life or any other kind of evidence that we want to see. He never spoke in tongues. He didn't even invite Jesus into his heart. He just said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. There'd be some today would say, now wait a minute, you need to pray. You didn't pray it quite right. But see, salvation isn't the words you say in a prayer. Salvation is your heart. And you crying out to God. God saw his heart. He never joined or became active in a church. He never received the second blessing or was slain in the Spirit. Two things, by the way, that aren't taught in the Bible. I like this. He never sang Kumbaya or threw a twig on a fire or committed his life to full-time service. Which, by the way, that's kind of a misnomer too, because every Christian's in full-time service. There's no such thing in the Bible as a part-time Christian. Everybody's a full-time Christian in full-time service for the Lord. God didn't heal him, rescue him, bless him with material assets, or give him good health. But he said, today you'll be with me in paradise. He just trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior. And that's it. Period. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. William Cowper, C-O-W-P-E-R, the English call it Cooper. He was born in Hertfordshire, England, on November 15th, 1731. He was privileged to be born in the home of an English clergyman while his mother was from a prominent family of English royalty. In preparation for his life's work, he was educated in private schools and eventually earning a degree in law. With that degree, he later passed his bar examination and was licensed to practice as a solicitor in the lower courts of the English justice system. But in spite of his intellectual achievements, William Cowper was physically frail and emotionally sensitive throughout his childhood. One of the traumatic experiences he went through, emotional experiences, was the death of his mother when he was 6 years of age. Unable to properly deal with that grief he experienced as a small child, it stayed with him throughout his entire life. He never stopped grieving for his mother. Even though he passed his law examination and was licensed as a lawyer, the very prospect of appearing before the bar for his final examination frightened him to the extent that he had a mental breakdown and never recovered. As a result, he never practiced law, but preferred the study and writing of literature. Added to the anxiety, the bar exam was he was engaged at the time and his fiancée broke off the engagement. That resulted in an unsuccessful suicide attempt. He was therefore placed in an insane asylum for 18 months. While confined in the insane asylum, he suffered from prolonged periods of deep depression, but he began to spend large amounts of time reading the Bible. He began to remember his spiritual upbringing as a child and he became very concerned for his eternal destiny. He struggled with the question of his own salvation and peace with God. One day, reading the book of Romans, he came to these words in Romans 3, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God, while admitting His need of personal redemption and the sufficiency that is in the shed blood of Jesus, our Savior, being convicted by the Holy Spirit, William Cowper realized a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and a sense of forgiveness of sin. And he was gloriously converted at 33 years of age in 1764. He began to recover from his melancholy and mental depression. He moved out of the insane asylum and into the home of a retired minister named Morley Unwin, U-N-W-I-N. There he received the necessary spiritual encouragement and the patient care at the hands of Reverend Unwin and his wife Mary. After 5 years, Reverend Unwin died, and his widow decided it best, at the request of Reverend John Newton, to move with her family to Olney, England. William Cowper was invited to move with the Unwin family to Olney and to attend the church pastored by Reverend John Newton, who's the author of the hymn, Amazing Grace. While living in the Olney parish, William Cowper lived in a small house whose backyard joined the parsonage yard where Reverend Newton and his family lived. And there at Olney parish, Newton and Cowper became very close friends and worked together in the writing of religious poetry for the services of the church. Reverend Newton became a spiritual father to William Cowper and a real source of needed inspiration in helping him overcome his spells of religious doubt, mental depressions, and emotional morbidity. You see, even after Cowper's conversion, he endured several periods of where he seriously doubted the love of God for him and his security as a believer. He struggled with that. But both Newton and Cowper were very talented poets and writers of religious verse. They combined, they wrote a hymn book. It was the Olney, O-L-N-E-Y hymns. It had 349 hymns in it. And it was important contributions to musical worship in the early church. 67 hymns written by William Cowper while he lived there at Olney under the patient care of Mrs. Unwin and spiritual inspiration of his pastor, John Newton. The hymn that testifies of his final peace with the Savior stands out as one of the great hymns of the church and a monument to the grace of God. On the inspiration of the Holy Spirit with the words of the prophet Zechariah, Zechariah 13:1. Listen to this verse. In that day there shall be a fountain open to the house of David and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanness. In that day there shall be a fountain opened to the house of David and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanness. And with that fresh in his mind, he began to pen the words, there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stain. But the next verse says this: the dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sin away. It's a great hymn. I think it's number 41 in your book, is it? Do you have that, Bob? Why don't we turn there, would you please? William Cowper penned the words not long before his death in 1800. It was several years later that another man, Lowell Mason, an American living in Boston, put the music to the words. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. Sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. What a great song. think it's appropriate we close our service with that tonight. All right, let's stand together and sing it, shall we? Number 41. Do you have it, Brother Bob? My Brother Bob, come. Let's sing it. Sing it to the Lord. Sing it out. Sing it as a praise and a rejoicing to the Lord, will you?
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day, and there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Dear dying Lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Here since by faith I saw the stream thy flowing wounds supply, redeemed has been my theme and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die.
We're going to sing that last stanza and just start us, Sally, and then we'll go without the instrument from there, all right? And lift your voice up to the Lord, all right? You know, I never hear those last two verses. I heard Curtis Hudson sing that when he was dying of cancer. And he sang about, will be my theme till I die. And then he sang that last stanza, when this poor lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave. And he won't be able to sing then. You'll sing in heaven. But let's sing it now. I'd sing that last stanza and lift it up to the Lord, all right?
Then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to save. When this poor lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave, lies silent in the grave, lies silent in
Praise the Lord. Well, remember now, tomorrow night, pray for the prison, the RU inside down there. Friday night for RU right here. And then Saturday morning, we have a regular visitation and soul winning here at 10 o'clock. And then remember Saturday night at 6 o'clock, Sunday night at 6 o'clock, the choir cantata, Lift Him Up. And you'll enjoy that. So hope you invite folks to come out on Saturday evening and be your guest. And, you know, say, well, I'm going to come Sunday night. Do I got to come Saturday night? It really won't kill you. There's some of us going to be here both nights. And, you know, it would be all right. And you have a great, it's a great message, a great story. And pray, Lord, really use it. All right. And then these are the flyers. These are the half sheets. And then the sheets that will go into the stores or the churches. All right, 11 by 17. They're very sharp, good flyers. They're in sets of two, okay, rolled up. So you can grab a couple and invite somebody to come and be your guest. That's on April 18th, all right? All right, let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you so much for this evening. Lord, we do want to pray for those who are unable to be with us tonight because of illness, and we lift them up before you. We do pray for Heather Joy tonight, who had took a fall at her home, and she's hurting this evening, and I pray that your healing hand be upon her. Lord, I pray that you'll touch the bodies of others who are battling illnesses, Lord, and unable to be with us in church, that you'll raise them up. They'll be with us by the weekend services for the Lord's Day. Father, we love you. Thank you for your death on the cross. And thank you, Lord, that it's never too late for anyone to come to know you as their Savior. And so, Father, I pray that we'll take the truth that we were reminded of this evening of the thief on the cross. And Lord, we realize that folks can turn in repentance and faith to Jesus and put their faith in him alone. Use us to tell others of Christ that we meet this week. May others see him in our lives, please. Help us to please you in all we do and live for your glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Let's sing Isn't He Wonderful, all right? Isn't he wonderful? Wonderful. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Let's hear you sing it. Isn't he wonderful? Wonderful. Wonderful. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? God bless you. You're dismissed. Choir, come right on up.